Hi, this is Maro from Whalley Work BC, and I'm reporting live an event that we're hosting today at the Whalley Work BC Center. It's to celebrate abilities today, because in BC, September is considered or celebrated as the Disability Employment Month, actually. So I'm going to be going in the room where they're actually having the event. We have guest speakers, Honorable Bruce Ralston, MLA, Whalley area, and we have Rod Stewart representing the Opportunities Funds, and he's going to talk about opportunities for funding opportunities for people with disabilities. I'm going to walk in the room and hope that you'll be able to hear the speakers, and there are also some cool stories that people are sharing.
What type of jobs are there out there for persons with disabilities that, you know, would help them? All of them. Somewhere in Canada, doing any job imaginable is someone with a disability. So every job you can think of can be done by somebody with a disability. So that's kind of my philosophy. There's work out there for everybody, and there's a very small, minuscule section of the population that either isn't working or can't find work. So for the rest of us, there is a job out there for everybody. So the BC Center for Ability, one of the main things people want to hear about is the Opportunities Fund. So the Opportunities Fund is a federally funded program that is administered through my agency, the BC Center for Ability. We look after Boston Bar all the way to Whistler. And what we are in the business of doing is funding people to go to school at post-secondary level to get training. And that training is ideally to lead to work in the field they're being trained for. So we fund things like books, tuition, travel, childcare, adaptive equipment, disability-related supports, and in some situations, living supports. So I get questions about living supports. Without going into too much detail, we can do a top-up for people that have a PWD status with the provincial ministry, a small amount, but it helps while they're in school. And for individuals who might lose their living support funding because whoever they deal with says, you can't go to school while you're with us, you have to do this, we will come in and replace that income. So just while you're in school, schooling has to be 6 months maximum. So we can't go any further than that. The other thing we do is wage subsidies. So if an employer steps forward and says, I'd love to hire this person, but for whatever the reason, things are tight right now, we come in and we provide the employer with up to 50% of the wages reimbursed to them for a period of up to 6 months. So it helps take the sting off of a new hire if perhaps they've got to have a manager be involved a bit more with the person. Or maybe the learning curve is a little longer and slower. So it helps get that person into the right job with the right employer at the right time. So we're not looking to create a charity situation. We want to help people get good jobs, the right skills for the right employer. That's the bottom line. So we come in as the funder. We also provide adaptive equipment costs, disability-related supports to the employer so that they can offset something that the client might need. So if the person needs a larger screen because of a visual impairment, we can purchase that on behalf of the employer. So we do a few other little things, but those are the main core things we do, and we've helped thousands of people over the last decade plus that we've been doing the Opportunities Fund. So I'm a little low tech. I asked about PowerPoint, and we decided that we're just going to show pictures. Because people don't remember stats. You're not going to remember 6 months and this and that. You're going to remember stories. So people always ask, 6 months, Rob, you know, what can I do with 6 months worth of training, or what kind of jobs have you helped people get? So I said, over the last year, the staff, we've got a list of what we've done. And we've got, these are jobs. So every one of these is a job that somebody has gone through school and gone on to get work, or they've got a wage subsidy. I struggle. People say, well, what type of work? I can never remember it. You know why? Because there's no one theme. There's no, oh, all we do is kitchen work, or there's all we do is construction, or all we do is this. It's all over the place. I mean, if I were to read down this, steel fabricator, intermediate bookkeeper, research and outreach specialist, recycler, kitchen assistant, nursery worker, cabinet maker, barn equestrian hand, it's all over the place. So we like to think that we do all kinds of different things for people because there's all kinds of different work out there. So here's my low tech. Truck drivers. We have helped lots of people get on the road with class one driver training, driving trucks all around the province right now, and they all have a disability. This is not somebody we helped. It's a good looking guy. I'm sorry we're not high tech today, but this is heavy equipment operator. This is a client. We helped him get behind this backhoe. He is working now. He's making very good money. This is exactly what he wanted to do. When we say disability, a lot of people go to schizophrenia and wheelchair user. And yes, those are disabilities. There are many, many across the spectrum. This could be somebody who has 5% hearing loss. That qualifies. Somebody who's a diabetic. That qualifies. Somebody with a missing digit. That qualifies. Bad backs. That qualifies. So disability can be all shapes and forms and all variabilities within a particular spectrum. So this is the money shot. So for those of you who can't see, this is an underwater welder. So this is our most expensive plan ever. I'm not going to tell you how much it cost. So we were approached on this, and I'll tell you, we agonized over this. The team sat and we debated, because it's like Dragon's Den. Somebody comes in, one of the staff, and they say, here's what we want to do. And they try to convince everybody else. And we all fought back. I don't know about this. I don't know about that. Ultimately, the decision was a yes. So what we had here is somebody who had diving experience, lots of it. Somebody that had welding experience, lots of it. And he said, I want to do underwater welding. So the school, I think, is in Camel River. So we paid for accommodations over there. We paid for ferry to go over there. We paid for living costs. We paid for tuition. We paid for equipment, everything. Last I heard, this guy's making about 90 grand a year. He's very happy. He has a disability. He's working. We don't do these every day. So if you're thinking about it, make sure you have welding and diving experience. But for everybody else, as I said, there is a job. And it's about getting the right job, the right training, the right person with the right employer. Part of what I also do is employer engagement. I want to see employers be disability confident. I want them to be happy to hire people with disabilities. I want them to understand people with disabilities have a lot to offer. Let's look at the skill set. And if you hire them, how can you make it work? Most accommodations are under $500. Some accommodations cost nothing. It's simply a shift in the working schedule. Sometimes it's a piece of adaptive equipment. So I don't want employers to freak out and be scared that they're going to be sued if they ask the wrong question. I want them to be confident and know that there's a huge portion of the population out there that is looking for work, and if you are struggling to fill your staffing needs, start to look around. Broaden your search. Throw your net a little further, because there's lots of people. Folks here, find the people, marry them to the right programs. We go out and we help with the employer engagement. You guys do the training, you do the learning, and you come out. So, I mean, that's kind of what we do. That's why I'm happy to come out on a day like today and talk to you. I'm going to be around for a while, so if anybody wants to talk to me, my name is Rod, BC Center for Ability, Ops Fund. It's my 15 minutes. Okay.
Well, thank you, Rod. So as we mentioned, he has a few minutes, so if you have any questions, please feel free to ask him questions. And at the end, feel free to go to the our little youth room, because we do have a lot of refreshments and snacks for you, so don't leave without eating, because we can't eat all of that food, okay? Thank you. Okay, and now it is my pleasure and honor to invite Ward Kinley, constituency assistant to the Honorable Bruce Ralston. Let's give him a big hand.
Thank you. I'm going to continue to pretend to be nervous. My name is Ward Kinley, and I'd like to share with all of you today my story. It's very exciting. I've been feeling very, very excited lately. There's a couple of reasons for this. My life has developed a lot since I lost my legs a few years ago. The term is bilateral below the knee amputation. While I was recuperating from the operation, trying to think of a career that would work with my new situation in life, and I couldn't think of anything that would be relevant to my skill set. But it took by the time spring 2017 came around, my stumps had healed to the point where I could actually get up off the couch and do some walking. So I decided I was going to find something that I could commit to that would benefit my community, friends, and neighbors, as well as myself. During my life, I've been involved with giving back to the community quite often. I enjoy the feeling that you get of doing good deeds for others. So on my 50th birthday, I decided I was going to form Surrey Whalley MLA Bruce Ralston's campaign. It was during the election year, and asked if I could be of any assistance during the re-election. They said, yeah, sure, come on board. I spent the next few weeks working nearly every day to help get Bruce MLA Ralston re-elected for his fourth term. I was beginning to wake up happy again because I had found something that was important to me to do. It was important, I think, exciting and exhilarating to find something you enjoy doing. To get up in the morning with a smile on your face and look forward to going to work is something that should be coveted, not squandered. It's important. Soon after he was elected, MLA Ralston, who had often complimented me during the campaign for my contributions and skills, offered me a temporary part-time position in his constituency office. I was excited at the opportunity, but at the same time, quite a bit nervous. At first, I was working half days, which slowly increased to full time after a few months. I worked hard, enjoyed the work, and was getting more and more comfortable with the career choice that seemed to allow me to help my neighbors in this community. As Minister of Jobs, Trade, and Technology, Honorable MLA Bruce Ralston is very busy in his role, but always has time to be out in our community, meet with constituents, and represent the government at events and meetings around the province. MLA Ralston has been very positive in working with me to give me the confidence and skills to excel in my work as his temporary constituency assistant. He has told me many times how good I am with people and that I'm also good at helping them solve the challenges they meet. Through my own experience, I know all about the hard knocks that can be tossed at you in life. And in my job, I take it as a personal challenge to find solutions for the problems that people in Surrey Whalley face. Why am I telling you my story today? September is Disability Employment Month. And on September 3rd, Bruce Ralston, MLA for Surrey Whalley, hired me on as his permanent full-time constituency assistant. For a long time, I had no goals, no dreams, no hopes. But Bruce has shown me through the kindness and commitment that puts into his work for his constituents and his dedication he has in helping every single person who comes through his door, no matter how different they are. Bruce did not see me for my disability, but rather he saw my qualities, skills, and abilities. I'm very thankful to the Surrey Whalley MLA Bruce Ralston for giving me a chance to live it again. Thank you, Bruce.
What an amazing and inspiring story. These are stories that we see on a daily basis. You know, Options has such an amazing team that's always willing to help. And even though Ward did not get the help from Options, we know that there are employers out there that have such a kind heart that are willing to hire anyone. Just don't give up. Don't give up your dream. I mean, it's a route that you'll have to take. There's going to be a few little bumps there, but just like Ward's story, it will, at the end of the day, will be successful. Okay, now I would like to welcome Haley. She is Haley Rao. She's one of our clients who also would like to give a little testimony about her. It's always amazing to hear how people's lives are changing through employment, and especially when you have to face so many barriers. So let's hear it for Haley. And she's nervous too.
I am so nervous. Okay. I wrote this whole speech, but I probably am not even going to read it. Wow. Oh my goodness. I am very nervous. I really start writing, and I couldn't come to this conclusion of how to start it, and then I realized I had nothing to lose if I stand up here and make a fool of myself. So whatever, here I am today. I'm just going to cut to the chase. Obviously, I'm standing in a disability workshop, and I look completely normal. But on the inside, I'm not. I struggle with mental health, and I have my entire life. Ooh, I'm really nervous. and I have my entire life. It was brought on at a very young age, and I went untreated until I was about 20. I have a long list of diagnoses that I could really ramble up to you, but I'll tell you my main, which is post-traumatic stress disorder, borderline personality disorder, and anxiety. As you can see, shaking. not many people are aware of what borderline personality disorder is, and that is when you are not able to regulate your emotions. So my entire life, I went not knowing what emotions were, which is an extremely hard thing to do because emotions are something that are just so natural, but for me it was not. So a lot of the symptoms, especially the ones that I had, were I always had a feeling that people were gonna leave me. I always had unstable relationships. My self-image was absolutely horrible. Thanks for standing back there. Friends back there. impulsive and self-destructive behaviors. Like, I have come very far in my life. Like, I have not always been a very well put together person. And I am not all the time. I'm a single mom of a 2-year-old, so this doesn't normally look like this. Extreme emotional mood swings and chronic feelings of emptiness. And last but not least, addiction and serious anger issues. I struggled with all these my entire life until I was 20, and it really sucked. And let me tell you this, you know that quote, you're only as old as you feel? I'm 25, but I feel like I'm freaking 60 some days. I'm currently a mom to my son. He was born Christmas Day 2015. He's my little miracle baby. I was told I couldn't have kids. So, yeah. I recently just left, actually, sadly enough, an abusive toxic relationship with my son's father. He was unable to stay clean. He couldn't maintain his mental health. And it's hard, you know, so you gotta do what you gotta do. I've been clean for 5 years myself, but I didn't really get help with my mental health until I was about a year in. You think that once you get clean and sober, life is going to be perfect? Well, it's definitely not. You get more crazy after. At least I did. I'd like to say I'm strong, independent. I think I'm funny, but it really depends on who you ask. Like I said, I have almost 5 years clean. I go to therapy. That really is the only thing that saved my life in the end, was actually doing the work for yourself if you guys have a mental illness. I strongly suggest that. My therapist is my best friend, sadly enough. Okay, let me go on. So here, let's go get down to business now. Enough about me. I can go on giving you information about my mental health, my prior unstable life, my abuse, my trauma, my addiction. But that's not why we're here today. I would personally like to say thank you to all the WorkBC staff for all their hard work, the front administration and the resource room staff for all my endless questions, proofreading, computer usage, help with the printers, and of course the coffee that they would brew for me, because I would be sitting here for hours on the computer typing away. I'm like, yeah, I'm a mom, so I need coffee. Yeah, they're really good to me, and I'm really grateful. What did I expect from this program? Well, honestly, I thought I was gonna walk in here and snap my fingers and go to school, but that is not what they had planned for me. And now that I see how far I've come, I've been working with Samar, which is my caseworker, for about 6 months. And when I walked into her, I said, look, I'm ready to go to school, I'm gonna do this. And she said, mm-mm, I have faith in you, you're gonna go to school, but you need to do all this work for me. And I had absolutely no understanding of why she wanted me to do it. There were so many times where I wanted to give up. She was like, volunteer here, and do this testing here, and do this and do this. And I was like, oh my gosh. But in the end, you know, look where I am. I'm standing in front of you guys. You, Sarah, I'm talking to you back there. My application will be going. She made me, like I said, she made me do a lot of tasks that I really thought was a waste of time. I knew what I wanted, so give it to me, right? Wrong. Samar made me work so hard, I wanted to give up many times. I endured a lot of personal issues while being connected with her, and she was also very helpful in understanding of these. Like I said, I left a relationship all while trying to go back to school because in the end, you know, it's about me and my future and what I gotta do. She really gave me the push to see the woman that I am today, and I'm really grateful for her for that. She really is a true life superhero. She never gave up on me, and I thank her daily for this. Work BC has provided me with structure I needed to gain business ethics and gain better professional relationships, self-confidence, and a greater foundation of networking and in-depth information about what my educational goals will look like. I cannot say this enough, but thank you, Samar. She's not here today, or she'd be like probably crying. She's very sensitive. But you're amazing and you rock, so pass the message along to her. And thank you for not giving up on me when I didn't see a light at the end of the tunnel. Where am I headed? That's the question. I know you're all wondering, why is this woman just standing up here rambling? And what does she want to do with her life? Well, over the course of the year, I've been working hard, almost daily on my work. We see application groups, outside supports, cover letters, you name it. Certain platforms I like to support, which I will address in the end. Today, I can confidently say I will be going back to school, please. going back to school to become a community support worker specializing in social work. During my networking, I had received a position already. I'm not even in school yet. I received a position to do my, received my position to do a practicum, and they hopefully would like to have a job with me after, and that is through a mental health facility in Vancouver. And that was all through networking, through Work BC, them pushing me. I'm proud of myself, so to me it shows that I can do this all. My long-term goal is to work with at-risk children. As we all know, we are in a serious drug epidemic, and it seems like it's never going to come to an end. My solution is to start helping the children of the addicts, of those who pose a risk to themselves. This can help prevent addiction in the future. I'm a perfect example of someone who did not have proper resources as a child of an addict, and that led me to addiction at 12. My goal is to make a difference in this world. Somehow, some way, I'll make it happen, little step by little step. My overall conclusion is to this, is that I would not be where I am today if it was not for all the staff at Work BC. The work they encouraged me to do, the classes they offered, the resources they provided, and the dedication to their clients. I am honored, thankful, and grateful for everything. My application for school is still in the process of being accepted. I hope today, standing up here, you can have a better understanding of who you're helping and why. This is me. I've made mistakes. I've lived and I've learned. But I'm so grateful for everything. Before I end this, I would like to take a few minutes to just address a couple things. Like, mental health is a very common issue. As time goes on, the stigma of speaking about mental health is going down, so we talk about it more. But don't be afraid to reach out for help or to help someone you think is struggling. You could save a life in the end. Surrey has many resources and crisis lines. Thankfully, Work BC has already has all the information by the wall by the front entrance. Thanks for doing the homework for me. Another topic I will always speak about that is related to mental health, which is suicide awareness. Please, please take time for self-care, loving yourself, and seeking proper treatment. If you're struggling or know someone who is struggling, once again, Work BC did the homework for me, and there's pamphlets on the wall over there. Thank you for giving me your attention, and I hope this makes sense, and I did not make complete flawless. I believe we have one more. Maria, are you going to come?
Okay.
Maria is the parent of one of our clients, and she was nervous. She's very nervous to speak, just like me, but she'll pull it off, just like I do.
Okay, my name is Maria, and I have a son who has disabilities, and I am very thankful to options for Work BC because my son, through this program, my son got a position a volunteer, or working as a volunteer. Very, very happy, and he is very, I am happy, and he is happy. And also, I am very thankful and grateful to Mrs. Cowan, because she helped my son very, very much in many ways. Very happy. And also, I am very happy. This is my first time. I have never been here. I feel a little nervous, but I am happy because before I didn't know about this program option, and I know because I passed by. I went to London Drugs. I passed by and I saw a sign option, and I decided to find out. I said I will go and find out what this program is about, and I am very happy when I got the information. Oh my God, this is for my son. And it was for my son. When I find out everything, and I read all the information in the pamphlet, I said, this is the program I was looking for. And I am very happy. And after I find out more about other services which this program provides, and therefore I feel happy. And it's not only for disability, it's not for many people.
Who are looking
for work.
Yes, that's right.
Thank you so much.
Well, now it is my pleasure and honor to introduce our MLA for the story writing, Mr. Bruce Ralston, who's also our BC Minister for Jobs, Trade, and Technology. Please come to me.
Thanks very much. It's hard to know what to say after listening to Ward, Haley, and to Maria. I do want to say that it's really an honor to, on behalf of the government, to be able to celebrate this month. The fact that I made the decision to hire Ward this month was totally coincidental. I don't think I knew at the beginning of the month that this was Disability Employment Month. So, but I think I didn't hire Ward because of his disability. I hired him because of what he could do, his relations with people, his skills, and his knowledge and the way people respond to him. I was aware of who he is, but that really wasn't a factor in the decision to hire him. So all I would say, confronted or after listening to those very inspirational stories, is that I don't think, my sense is that employers don't necessarily know what's going on with you, and you may be more conscious of what you think you don't have, and whereas the employer is looking for what you have. And so I think it's sometimes our own self-image is defeating, and I think that's probably the biggest challenge in some ways. The other good news, and I speak more in the ministerial side, is that a lot of companies, a lot of agencies, I meet with a lot of companies, I travel the province, a lot of people are looking for people to employ. It's 5% unemployment. Some of the economists consider that to be full employment. So the opportunity now probably is better than it is ever likely to be in a long time, or has been in a long time, for employers to think seriously about hiring not necessarily conventional employees, but look to people who they might not have otherwise considered. And so I think it's a good time to be positive. It's a good time to work with the people at Work BC. They have a whole network of connections throughout the province, and their programs are pretty focused on the labor market. So sometimes people need a little brush up or training to be labor market ready, I think is the jargon term. But it's a good time. It's a really a good time to reach out there. So I wish all those employers. I don't know who are there. Employers in the room, or pardon me. Any employers here? Okay. Okay. But people who are looking for work, I think I would just leave you with those thoughts. And I'm really happy to be able to celebrate on behalf of the government. This is a program that's a government direction. not the minister responsible, but WorkBC has the full support of the government and the premier and the cabinet and everyone in this effort. And so best wishes and hang in there. I think good things can be done and will be done, especially in times like this. So thank you very much for inviting me. It's always great as a member of the MLA for Surrey Whalley to be able to get out and do something in my riding. Sometimes the time isn't always there. So if I'm not there, you've got Ward to count on who will represent me very ably. So thank you very much.
I would like to invite Jackie. She's our senior manager of the WorkBC program. I would like her to come and speak and her final words. And I just want to thank everyone for coming and just want to reiterate, please don't leave without grabbing some food, okay? Thank you.
So that's an end to all the lovely stories that everybody shared. And sorry if some of you were not able to hear some of the speakers. I couldn't get any closer. Thank you for watching. And if you're looking for work, if you want to, or if you want to hire, if you're an employer, please come drop by, call us, and we'll have information on services that we can provide for people if you have special needs. We do have vocational counselors who can help with finding the right fit of job for you, your right training. They can also help you with assessments and accommodations. Same goes for the employers. Please do not hesitate or think twice about hiring anybody with a disability, because you need to be looking at their skills and abilities. And we are here to help you and support you if there's any kind of accommodations required. WorkBC is there to support you in that process. Give us a call. We're just a phone call away. Thank you so much. This is Whalley WorkBC Options site out. Thank